Yeah, so y'all keep him in your prayers. And I hear the older you get, when you get that, it's a little bit tougher to deal with. So y'all pray for him tonight and keep him in your prayers. I want to make note as well, for the next few weeks, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about it in a minute. Next few weeks, we're going to be having some of our ministers in training and ministers to minister to us on these Wednesday nights before we take our summer break. Of course, y'all know Victory Basketball is getting ready to be starting. Looking forward to that. Victory Basketball. Looking to be starting that. Our evaluations will take place on May 6th and 7th. So if y'all know some people that's still interested, I think it's 13 days left that people can register. We have paper registrations that's out there just in case you know some people who are not as internet savvy, and they'll like to sign up, take a few of those with them, and they could bring those papers with them to the evaluation on that Monday or Tuesday at the high school. We will, on May the 5th, we will need as much help as we can. That's when we'll be taking, that's annually when we'll take the goals up to the high school. So on that Sunday after church, we'll be doing that. So I'll be getting with the guys and anyone that can help us out. We're really, really going to need some assistance with that. And what we, of course, do is during Victory Basketball time, we take off on Wednesday nights during the month of June. And then we're going to be coming back in the month of July for our Vacation Bible School. Everybody say Vacation Bible School. We're going to be back here for Vacation Bible School. I don't know about any of y'all. I grew up on Vacation Bible School. I grew up summertime. I couldn't wait for Vacation Bible School to get some red juice and some lemon cookies and come out and sing some of those children's songs. Father Abraham and many sons, and many sons had Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. Right up left, Father Abraham and many sons. Y'all remember that? Y'all remember them kind of songs? Yeah, so them VBS songs, I think we kind of need to resurrect some of them songs and teach our kids so they ain't just walking around here singing Cardi B and Nicki Minaj and Lil Wayne and all the other little songs. They need to be singing some of these old songs we grew up on that gave us some substance. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? They gave us some substance. So in July, we'll be coming back for VBS. So be looking forward to that, and that's going to be a great time. So keep that in mind. I want to share this. We had a great time Sunday and as we celebrated Easter and Resurrection Sunday. Amen. So much so I say, let's keep the cross in here with all these names on it. And that was a real touching time to me to see people really passionate about getting their name on the cross. And I got just quite a bit of responses. We got quite a bit of responses from even our young people. I know, I think it was Monday, me and Philip, I picked him up from daycare. And he was asking me, he said, why did they kill Jesus? And he was like, why was they so mean to Jesus walking around in the church? And it was an opportunity for me to share with him the story. Then somebody else had shared with us on the internet that their son had watched and was watching the illustration and how they had an opportunity to share that. I'm going to tell y'all something. There's no story like the gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection that can change even the littlest of people's lives. There's something powerful about that story, and I'm grateful to God that we had a chance to get a good witness of what that was all about. So listen, tonight, last week we had Deacon Steve to share with us. We was in South Carolina last week with LaWalt, and he, of course, graduated from Army basic training, and Deacon Steve shared with us. Did he do a good job? He was good. Okay, cool. I ain't got to kick him out or nothing, do I? Okay, y'all be praying for him. He's dealing with a bad back issue, so y'all be praying with him. He's about 80 years old now, and it's starting to catch up with him. I'm just kidding, but no, he's dealing with a bad back issue, so let's be praying for him. He's trying to decide on whether or not if he's gonna have surgery on his back. So we're gonna be praying that God will heal him so he won't have to have surgery, in Jesus' name. So be praying with us about that. But tonight, we're gonna be having one of our ministers in training who I am just grateful for. Let me tell y'all something. oftentimes what people don't understand how tough it is to minister, or to pastor rather. And a lot of times what people also don't understand sometimes how different it is to pastor people you went to school with. Because sometimes you can pastor people and they can become so familiar with you that they don't respect you. You know, they're like, oh, that's such and such from the neighborhood, or that's such and such who I grew up with. But one of the things I'm grateful for, that God has blessed us with people in our church who I grew up with, who knows a lot of things about me, and which still blows my mind, and still respect me enough to still call me pastor. And Sister Ardry has been a gem in our church. She's been a blessing in our church. Even on Sunday, I didn't even know she was doing it. She came out in free will, just set up some stuff out there in the lobby. And she has a heart of gold. And Sister Ardry has just been a tremendous blessing to our ministry. But not only that, she's somebody I know who loves God, loves this church, and loves people. And so I'm not going to prolong it, y'all. So let's stand to our feet, everybody, and let's thank God for Sister Ardry as she comes to minister to us the word of the Lord. Woo! Come on, y'all. Y'all give it up real loud. Woo! Love you, girl.
Hello, everybody. How are y'all? So listen, it's something about getting in these doors, boy. I tell you, when you be going through all week, and I just say, if I could just make it to church. I know I hear people say all the time, church is not in the building, it's in your heart. But it's something about fellowship with my sisters and my brothers. And so sometimes when I could just get through them doors, I know I'd be all right. My scripture would be Acts 27:21-24, NIV. And I know y'all can just follow along on the screen. So after they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, "Men, you should have taken my advice and not sailed from Crete. Then you would have spared yourself this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost, only the ship will be destroyed. Last night the angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me and said, 'Don't be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you.'" So you can go ahead and be seated. Pastor already prayed. Lady Matt's already prayed. I think we covered. So in this particular, I'm just going to jump right in it, y'all. In this particular text, Paul finds himself shipwrecked on a ship with some sailors. Paul tried to give them instruction, but of course they didn't want to listen to what he had told them, so they found themselves shipwrecked. And in the scripture, Paul was telling them to not be afraid, that they would eventually make it to land, to where they was going. They ended up making it to an island, and if I believe, I want to say the island was called Malta. And so they ended up on an island. And in the particular text, it says that Malta was described as cold and damp in an unfamiliar place. How many of y'all this week find yourself in Malta, in an unfamiliar place, in a damp place, in a cold place? I know this week for me, my Malta is Ocala Opportunity Youth Academy. And so if you my closest and my dearest friend or my significant other, you've probably heard me talk about that Malta all week long. It's unfamiliar. It's not cold. It's a different place, because I'm probably the only one there from little old Lake Butler, and everybody else from Ocala and Brooksville and Tampa and all back that way. And so this week, that's my Malta, because each week you can find yourself in a different Malta. Each day you can find yourself in a different Malta. And so for this particular text, Paul ended up shipwrecked with the sailors in Malta. But the good thing about Paul being on there, he was able to encourage the sailors who had become desperate and had lost hope and was afraid that they were going to die because the storm was raging, and it describes it almost like a hurricane, like it was constant and, you know, just pretty much like a hurricane. And so they had lost hope and they thought they was going to die. So long story short, Paul was encouraging them and telling them, because the angel had told him that he wouldn't die, and because he was with them, they wouldn't die. So sometimes somebody else's decision will run you right into your destiny. And so as we go along in the text, Paul is, you know, encouraging them and telling them not to worry. And they end up on the island, on the small island called Malta. And so my first point, the title of my message is Doing a New Thing. And I didn't really want to get caught up too much in the title thing. But the title is Doing a New Thing, and I'll try to tie it up. Lord, let me speak this thing clearly like you gave it to me. And so I'm going to jump around a little bit because I want to say something about Pastor. One thing I admire about our pastor is whenever he's preaching, he can, like, take you there. Like, when he's in a particular text or somewhere in the Bible, you can, like, visually see it. It's like when he do the Easter thing, you, like, you sitting right there and you looking at Jesus on the cross. And you watching them whip, you can almost feel the pain, you know. And I always tell Pastor that I believe that's a gift from God, because he could take you right where he had in the text. And sometimes I'm sitting in the back, and I don't know about y'all, but I'm writing notes whenever he's doing his messages. But when I get home, the notes that I write ain't, you know, it don't make sense. It ain't like what he said. And I'm like, you know, it's all scribbled, turned all, you know, see, I, you know, it don't make sense. But, you know, you just put it together. But because I've been in my Malta for probably about the last month now, things have been hitting me so heavy, and I just believe God is doing a new thing in my life. And I believe he's doing something different with me, and I believe there's an assignment that I need to carry out. How many of y'all believe right now in your Malta there's an assignment that you need to carry out? But because you have let the devil deceive you, or the enemy deceive you, or somebody else's decisions, you have gotten stuck in your Malta. Well, see, God sent me tonight to tell you that even in your Malta, you can still carry out that assignment that he has for you. And so listening to that pastor preach, and, you know, just listening at some other people, you know, on the internet, because I love, on my way to work, I love listening at, you know, messages and going back and listening at pastor's old stuff and just thinking like, oh, okay, well, he said it that way when we was in church, but now I can hear it more clearly and I can understand it, and it speaks to me, you know, it touches my heart. And so as I've been going through my Malta, I ran up on this particular scripture and stuff about Paul, and it just stuck to me because, you know, I can kind of relate to it. And so as I was thinking about sometimes your timing. Sometimes we get so focused on timing. It's kind of like hopscotch. You know, when they're doing the hopscotch and you got to jump in. You got to jump in at the right moment. We get so focused on that right moment of jumping in that we forget the assignment, or we forget what God has told us to do. So we're still standing there on the sideline just waiting. Just waiting. And whoever turning that rope, like, okay, come on, Angela. Come on, Angela. Jump in, Angela. Jump in. But it's yesterday. Angela was supposed to jump in yesterday. We in next week, and Angela still ain't jumped in yet because she waiting on that timing. But sometimes that timing can be good for you, kind of like these soldiers, these sailors. Timing was good for them because they ended up with Paul, who got that word from that angel from God that told him, you won't die. Because, see, Paul had another assignment. God told him, you can't die today. I need you to talk to Caesar later on. So he knew if he had to talk to Caesar later on, he couldn't die today. So while you in your Malta, while you in your dark and your cold place, God is telling you, Pat, I got something for you to do next week. You can't give up today. You can't give up today, Sister Pam. I need you to go on through to next week. I got something for you to do at the end of the road. See, my other Malta was last week when I was on the side of that road and I thought I was dying. And I'm going to tell you, for a minute, it took me to this week to realize the significance of what happened to me last week, because I kind of downplayed it, like, oh, okay, you know, it was just, you know, you just had a little arm pain and a little chest pain. You all right. The doctor said just get your diet right and you'll be okay. But how many of y'all done seen 10-year-olds die with heart attacks? How many of y'all have seen healthy people die with heart attacks? So it took me to this week just riding in that car, and I thank you, Father, riding in that car by myself to really just grasp the significance and how good God is. Because, listen, God has spared me so many times. God has spared me so many times when I should have been dead, when I had a car wreck with a tree, y'all, that was probably as tall as me off the ground. We hit that tree dead on. My head went to the windshield, bust the windshield, walked out, nothing. Somebody seen my car, my cousin seen my car, she come, she said, is y'all alive? How can y'all be alive? Because y'all truck is like smashed up. Then the week after my mama died, I find two lumps in my breast. And then I go in to get my mammogram with Lady Max, went come out, and everything was clear. Okay, so I know the power of God. And so, like I say, I've been in my mortal for some time now. I've been in that unfamiliar place for some time now. But I know in the midst of my mortal, there's an assignment for me to do. There's something for me to do, something for me to carry out. So I'm not going to stand on the side looking at them, turning the jump rope, trying to decide whether I'm going to jump in. I'm hitting the ground running. Because, see, this is the third time for me. And I'm not a cat. I ain't got nine lives. From the car accident to the breast cancer to the almost on the side of the road by myself. There was nobody. All I could do was call on Jesus. And say, you know what I said? Okay, God. Well, if it's my time to go, I believe I'm going to wake up and I'm going to see your face. I went from being scared to praying like, okay, God. And then I said, uh-uh. No. Not like this. Not on the side of the road. I know this is not how it's going out. I'm serious when I tell you this is what I said to God. Not like this, God. Come on now. Come on now. Because this ain't what you told me. You told me I had to preach the gospel. You told me I had to help save some of your people. You told me I had to bring some of them single moms out. You told me I had to talk to some of those wives whose self-esteem was low, who needed to know how to be a good wife, how to be a good mama. That's what you told me. This ain't what you told me. All right, enemy, you could get on back behind me with that. You could take this chest pain. You could take this numbness. You could take this fear and this doubt, and you could take it all back to hell where it come from. Okay? And so, like I said, I've been in my mortal, but I know the timing is important. Some of us wait on things to happen before we move. Even when we know God has said move, we're still sitting there watching the jump rope. How much longer y'all gonna watch the jump rope? Or you gonna hit the ground running? And so my next point is adversity. And when I heard the message, it wasn't exactly like how I'm saying it. I can't get it exactly like, and I know that's God. I ain't supposed to get it like how I heard it. I'm supposed to tell it like how God told me to tell it. So I'm gonna tell it like how I got it wrote on this paper. We be waiting for opportunity before we think we can be successful. And we never think about sometimes our adversity is where we get our success from. Because if you would have never had the problem, you would have never knew you could do it. You get what I'm saying? My adversity was sitting home with my mama, sitting there crying, watching my mama, you know, going through whatever she was going through, and then, you know, the stuff that I was going through on my job. And I was thinking, Lord, why me? What is up with all this? Why is these people lying on me? These people say I'm drinking. I don't drink. What is this craziness? But through my adversity came my success. Because God had already blessed me. He had already given me that talent, but I couldn't see it because I was so wrapped up in all that other stuff because I was in my mortal. I was in my cold, my dark, and my unfamiliar place. And I was stuck there. And sometimes you find comfort there. I don't know about y'all, but sometimes you find comfort in that unfamiliar place because if you stay there too long, it becomes familiar to you. And you get comfortable with it, and then you don't want to move. But let me tell you something, that ain't of God. That is not. That's procrastination. That is not God. And so as the text goes along, Paul and the sailors have landed. They're on the land, and they're in Malta, and they meet up with the islanders. And so the islanders welcome them, you know, with open arms. Come on in, these, you know, new people, come on in. We're going to welcome you with open arms. And so as Paul gets there and he realizes in the text he's telling you, describing, you're telling you it's cold and it's unfamiliar and it's a dark place. And so he said he wanted to go warm himself up. He's going to go warm himself up. So he goes to build a fire. And so he thinks he's good. You know how sometimes when we bat out our mortal and we think we okay, we right there at the edge. Okay, I'm good now, God. All that's behind me, I'm good now. And as he lights the fire, a snake pop out the fire and bite him on the head. So he thought he was okay, and I'm good, and I'm becoming familiar, but that snake popped out. Where your snakes at this week? Whose snake popped out this week and bit them on the head? And so in the text, it tells you as the snake latches on to Paul's hand, it latches on. It don't just bite him and just go away. It latches on. It holds on. That must hold on to you. It holds on to you. And so as the snake holds on to it, it tells him that the islanders are standing around and they're looking. They're looking at Paul and they're watching the snake and they're wondering, like, what's going on? Why the snake, you know, this man don't come up, he done got shipwrecked. First he done been in prison, he done been thrown in jail for preaching the gospel. Then he done got on the ship with the sailors, with they crazy self ain't want to listen. He done told you if you had listened to me, this wouldn't happen. They end up shipwrecked and then they're in an unfamiliar, cold, dry place. Then he get there and the snake bite him. And then the islanders looking at him and they wondering what's wrong with him. Well, he must not. He can't be godly. He ain't no godly man. He can't be no godly man and all that's happening to him. How many of y'all done had that said about you? Oh, look at her husband. Look at her husband. She can't be saved. How she saved? Her husband drank. Hi. Hi. She can't be no preacher and her child in jail. She can't be this and whatever. I seen her cross town over there at the, you know, the dude drop in. Did I see her car at the bar? She can't be saved. There's no way she's saved. You know, you got those people. They watch your every move. I tell people this all the time, and it's so funny to me how people will judge you. They doing the same thing, but they will judge you for it. And then tell you you're not saved. And then I come back with, God made one set of 10 commandments. He didn't make one for the saved and then one for the unsaved. He made one for all of us, and we all supposed to live by him. So what I'm supposed to be doing, you're supposed to be doing too. Don't judge me if you can't get it right. Come walk a mile in my shoes and see how hard it is. And then maybe you will understand. And so as the islanders are looking at Paul and they're judging him whatever, and it's funny how Paul was in his multi and God used that adversity to turn it all around. How he did a new thing right there with Paul. Because that same hand that Paul used, that Paul got bit by the snake with, Paul later on healed a man on that same island with. Because after the islanders had seen him do this thing or the snake bite him and him not die, he was supposed to die. How many of y'all were supposed to die when something happened to you? How many people looking at us right now? Some of us don't know it. Some of us do know it. How people, you know, studying it right now, she should have been dead. What's wrong with her? How she still can get happy after all of that? I left her. What's wrong with her? How she could still go on and do good? I left him. How can he do good after I did that? I kicked him out of my church. How are they making it? I left that church. How they making it without me? They ain't got my money no more. I left that job. Oh, I fired her from that job intentionally just because I didn't like her. But she's still making it. But God. It's somebody out there. You might not know it, but I guarantee you somebody out there that thought you should have been dead a long time ago, but you're still alive. But God. And so while the islanders was looking at Paul crazy and wondering why he wasn't dead, they went back and they got the chief of the island, and so they brought the chief back, and the chief was like, okay, well, you know, you're going to have everybody. And listen, this is my ebonically speaking part of the Bible. If y'all haven't caught on yet, this is the ebonics part, okay? And so he brought them on back. Come on, y'all come on to the house. We're going to eat. We're going to have a good time. Paul going to come in here. He going to lay some hands, and, you know, we're going to have a good time. And so Paul goes in, and he prays for him, and he lays hands on him, and he heals him with that same hand that he had just got bit by the snake with. So through his adversity came his success. And see, Paul went there thinking, I need the islanders to get me off the island, but the islanders needed Paul. Come on. they needed Paul. They needed Paul to come lay hands on that man and save him. And so how many of y'all think about your adversity when you get in your mortar and you're going through whatever you're going through? Be still and wait and let God bless you. Don't tap out before it's over with, before you get that blessing. We tap out sometimes before we make it to the blessing. We never even, like the promised land, we tap out before we even get there. We got to endure some things. Especially as Christians, sometimes we get so lazy. It's like, okay, well, God, now you done say, you done promise me everything. You said I can get this, and this was going to happen. I was going to have all these riches and this, that, and the other. And the first time your phone gets shut off or somehow, oh, well, what's going on? Or the first time somebody don't like you, well, why they don't like me? I'm saved. They supposed to like me. Everybody's supposed to like me. No. No, they're not. 9 times out of 10, about 7 of them ain't gonna like you. So keep it moving. At least that's what I do. And so just remember through your adversity, when you're going through your mortar, wherever you are, that's what I come to tell you this week, wherever you are in your mortar, just remember that there's an assignment somewhere in that mortar. There is something for you to do. There is a blessing. And let's not get so caught up on the monetary blessings either. Because that blessing come in health. My mortar brought me to my blessing in the form of health. Thank you, Jesus. I am alive to stand up here tonight, because when I tell you the enemy threw so much stuff at me this entire month, like this one thing after the other thing after the other thing, and it's like, nope. I know Sister Pat probably get tired of me talking to her. My sister Deidre probably get tired of me talking to her. Sister LaShonda probably get tired of me talking to her. My kids probably get tired of me talking to them. But guess what? I know there's assignment in the midst of my mortar. So I'm not giving up. I'm not giving up. When I came in here with a headache, but I done talked through the headache. Because there's an assignment in my mortar. And so my last point, because I'm going to get out y'all way because I'm about to talk y'all to death. You got to remember that in your opposition has to come. It comes to keep you aware of where God is in your life. God reminds you of him being God, because sometimes we forget and we think we're doing it on our own. But God said, no, I'm going to come in and I'm going to let something happen just so you can know that I am who I say I am. Because I don't care how big you think you are, how much Bible scripture you think you are, or what degrees you got behind your name, I am still God at the end of the day. And sometimes I need to remind you of who I say I am. And so I'm learning to understand when God is doing something in me, through me, around me. And that song tonight, Lady Metz and Pastor's song, This Is How I Fight My Battles. Listen, I'm telling you, y'all better know how to pray. You better know how to pray. You better know what the power of prayer. When you get in your mortar, you better learn how to pray your own self out of your mortar. Because when you can't call your mama, you can't call your dad, and you can't call your pastor, because it's 100 of us, and he praying for all of us. And so you better learn how to pray for yourself to get yourself out your mortar. And so my last point is reminder. God reminded Paul who he was in him by guiding the wind. He guided the wind at the beginning. I'm not going to try to say I know whether God wrecked the ship or not. I don't know if God did that. But I know God controls the wind, so he guided the wind. He took them to Malta. And he reminded Paul who he said he was. He set him on the island. He allowed the snake to bite him. He allowed the islanders to doubt him. And then he used them to heal him. So remember that all of those things took place. All of those things take place throughout your life, throughout your week. So remember, as you're going through your mortar this week, just remember that there is a blessing and there is an assignment in your mortar. Thank you.